Nobody rock the chair, grandma. Nobody move. Nobody get away. Knowing how many people at any given moment can just be gripped by an unfathomable despair has never been lost to me. Despair doesn't have to have any rationale. Sometimes you can just feel that. And sometimes you can just look at the world and see what seems like a senselessness and wonder why even care? Why even care for myself?
Terence Trent D'Arby exploded onto the music scene in 1987 when his first album sold over 1 million copies in the first 3 days of its release. He was the pop icon of the late 1980s. But underneath his legendary ego was a vulnerable young man.
The overwhelming impression I had of my experience was that by the time I was able to kind of finally maybe get comfortable in a chair, it had been pulled out from under me.
Terence Trent D'Arby, now known as Sananda Maitreya, has undertaken an extraordinary personal and spiritual journey that's seen him lose his original identity and gain a new one. This is the first time he's told his story.
Going through these fields of despair and misery have their value, but you must only see it as walking through a field. This too will pass. And just hang on.
He overcame personal anguish through finding his own inner faith. Sananda isn't a follower of organized religion, but he is deeply spiritual. Sananda is a Buddhist name meaning savior of the universe, and Maitreya, a reference to the tree of life.
When I was seeking to explain a few years ago why Sananda, one of the analogies that I used a lot was, at one point, a caterpillar is known by one name, and that name simply will not suffice when it becomes a butterfly because it was not even the same life. I've always been aware that there was something else I was involved with anyway. Growing up in the environment that I did, it was kind of impossible not to. That was certainly a good part of the education I got as a child, was it has never not been apparent to me that I walk with something, and that I've just gotten a lot closer with that something.
When fame called out to Terence, he wasn't ready for it. The overnight success of introducing the hard line came like a bolt out of the blue.
It was all at once very galvanizing and yet very distancing. It was a trauma to have something so dramatic happen to change your life literally from one day to the next. It's very, very traumatizing. Even if you're liking it for a while, it's still something that slaps you around in a hurricane of stuff. It was a tremendously traumatizing experience. Especially since a lot of it you spend trying to parlay the fame into replacing a love you didn't feel you got, which then leads you down its own kind of treacherous path. Time I'm sure will bring disappointments in so many things. It seems to be the way.
Terence Trent D'Arby craved love and attention. Now, with the world at his feet, he struggled to stay grounded.
I have to be honest and say that it was never a big drug thing. It was never a big anything. The most dangerous thing I found was just, it was the women. It was looking outside of myself for something that I was desperately seeking that poor things couldn't possibly give me.
Sananda Maitreya is the eldest of 6 children. His mother, Frances Howard, later married the Reverend James D'Arby, a minister of the Pentecostal Church, and Terence was brought up in the church's strict way of life.
For a very, very long time, the only music that was allowed was that which was considered of true gospel origin. there were even many households where there were certain types of gospel music that wasn't encouraged because it was considered too modern.
He found church life stifling and cold. His earliest memory of singing stands out as an occasion where he received love and warmth.
My earliest singing experience I remember as vividly as if it were yesterday, because I was about 4 years old and I was asked to sing a song. But I can remember that when I walked off, I was intercepted by this very large-breasted woman who immediately smothered me and gave me this huge hug. That obviously moved something very deeply within me, because, you know, when you're at that age and that occurs, you just, it's such a primal way to be received and accepted.
Delicate like rain, delicate like snow, delicate like birds.
Delicate was the first of several songs which offered a window into Terence's soul.
A songwriter's best friend is just remaining in touch with the truth and authenticity of what you're feeling. So writing songs or being the recipient of songs is a grace. I know I've never taken that for granted. Therefore, I can't just record some stuff that has no significance to me. I remember at the time feeling that there were very few male songwriters who seemed comfortable expressing the feminine side of our nature. At the time, I mean, music was such a brutal-minded place. Everything was, you know, bitch, I'll slap you up, you know, and it just kind of, it just seemed necessary to reassert back into the larger pie something very delicate, something very vulnerable.
Delicate like words, delicate how time.
The song basically celebrates our vulnerability. It's easy to praise, and it's correct and fitting that we should praise that very rugged masculine side of all of our natures, women included, but that there is not only no shame in a man acknowledging the softer side of his nature, but it's a necessary survival characteristic.
Delicate like you, my dear. Delicate like me, my love. Delicate like you. Delicate like me. Delicate like
it was certainly not calculated move to you know, of a very simple song, but it was just the way the song set itself up. Songs tend to come to me the way they come, and maybe, you know, I just finished something. So it came as with Delicate already as a part of its mantra.
If you let me stay, I'll say what you say. If you let me stay, I'll say what you say.
When I perform, the whole point is to basically do what is necessary to evoke all of us to take our masks off, lay them aside for a little while, and let our souls be massaged. I mean, to let that which is underneath the mask, yearning to breathe, to get that thing, that energy shake up, and to share it. That's the whole purpose.
Terence Trent D'Arby got a huge kick out of performing, but he was perceived to be arrogant, and it set him at odds with those around him.
There were times when it seemed that others took it a lot more seriously than I did, but then again, I might have been playing psychological games with myself just to survive it.
Now do you love me?
Do You Love Me is another song that tells us about Terence's need for security.
In my experience, all good songwriting is prophecy. The great thing about lyrics, they really are, whether conscious or unconscious, they're the truth of what's going on in your subconscious mind or your conscious mind. Do You Love Me Like You Say is an entertaining way, hopefully, of expressing that I'm missing something.
No matter how much Terrence achieved, he always felt there should be something more.
There was a period of time where I needed to take some time away from that to give to myself what I was expecting. I was expecting others to provide for me, which of course they couldn't.
Terrence was asking what the world really felt about him. It was a dangerous question to put. Terrence Trent D'Arby moved to Los Angeles in 1993. While he was there, he wrote one of his best-known tracks.
You're a top man on the scene. You don't think life comes in between. But hey, she's just 17. She feels that she's a worldly girl. But man, you've been around the world. She is just some worry, daddy's pearl. Even though there's nothing I can say to cheat you in nature anyway, let her down easy, her heart is on a dime.
Terrence's pop star status meant sex was always easily available, even if it didn't solve his problems.
I was mixing Symphony of Damn in a studio in Los Angeles. There was a very sweet young lady that was the studio manager at that particular studio. And boy met girl. And basically, by next day, boy realizes, maybe not good thing. Because this also kind of infringes upon your work environment, and that was maybe an undisciplined thing to have done. And please do not lead her on. When I came to the studio the next day to work, I was approached by this particular young lady, and I kind of realized that I would just have to call on whatever chivalry I was able to and let her down easy.
Let her down easy, her heart is on.
So that's where that came from, is trying to basically say that, you know, once you've realized a certain thing has to be done as a man of experience, you know, do it as sweetly as you can. Leave them with as much dignity as possible.
Let her down easy, her heart is on the line. Let her down easy and you'll.
Many people have asked me over time, was that song a personal projection with regard to writing about a daughter? It wasn't intended that way. It has certainly struck many people as that, and I don't wish to discourage them. I've come to realize as well that a songwriter doesn't have any more rights to say what a song is. It's just my interpretation. You are just as authentic in whatever it conjures up for you.
None of Terrence Trent D'Arby's follow-up recordings achieved the same success as the first two albums. By the time he completed touring in 1995, Terrence's desperation had turned to despair. Rejected by his public, he was on the brink of suicide.
I had some experiences on a European tour which just made it very clear that I was just going to have to surrender to this thing that was going on. I had had quite a few experiences which would have been perhaps prescribed as mystical or cosmic experiences, which were also interspersed with a lot of deep dragons which had to be soothed and had to be come to terms with.
Can you transform the pain you feel?
It was a time in my life where I really felt forces seemed to be conspiring to just tear me apart. Luckily, at some point, I realized if that were the case, there was nothing I could do and surrendered to it and let it and tear what apart exactly? Anyway, only your last idea, which is usually must be surrendered because it's usually gotten too small and no longer serving your growth process.
Find your way back.
pop star, Terence had basked in public approval. Now this public rejection forced him to rethink the whole basis of his life.
Having never really had a successful relationship to that identity anyway, once it was exacerbated by fame, it only heightened also the negative aspects of it. There was a period of time where I was just at a quandary. I really, really was as close to suicidal. In fact, had attempted it and had screwed that up. You know, it was like, and I was in that state of mind, like, okay, I couldn't even do that right. And it was just kind of clear that I wasn't going to be successful in that. So that I would have to basically die another way. In essence, it was the process of resurrection. There's a Messiah inside of you. Yeah. Reincarnation does not just happen between lives. We can reincarnate in a life. You don't have to, you know, change bodies. You can just change spirits. On the negative side of the world. I'm subject to moments or whims she fancies. The necessity to embrace my future. The necessity to say, you know what, I'm not going to wait until I physically die to reincarnate. I have to do it now. It wasn't a choice. What I went through put me in a situation where to survive, I had to just surrender to the only thing that could have possibly helped me survive, which is just diving into the fire completely.
When Terence left London and moved to Los Angeles, it was a turning point in his life.
Los Angeles for me was a great place to die. It was where Terence went to die. And it was where Sananda, in essence, began to make it apparent that if I were to survive, he would have to basically take over. It was a place of tremendous transition for me. I was also able, however, to see in that environment more clearly who I really was again, in a way that began to lead me back to something that spoke of a me beyond just a physical life. The truth, as much as I could possibly express it, is that the life as Terence really feels honestly like a past life. The bottom line is that that kid took all that he could and hung on for dear life, and at some point his prayers were heard and his misery and suffering were ended, and someone else kind of came in and said, I'll live the rest of this, don't worry.
He'd hit rock bottom. Now he felt it was time for Terence to die and for Sananda to take over.
People are afraid of the power that they really are. We're not encouraged to really reach for it, so it's a stranger to us. And we're pretty much punked out of it by the time we're 7 years old. We usually have given up any hope of really living our authentic selves, and we begin to adopt the customs of the tribe closest to us. However, if there is something authentic that remains in you that wishes enough to reestablish itself, it is inevitable that its wish will be respected by the angels whose job it is to make sure they listen out for such requests.
The root of Terence's anxiety and the depression which almost got the better of him lay in his childhood.
Yeah, I had a lot of anger from my childhood that I still needed to work through. And I also had to work through the fact that deep down inside I didn't think that I deserved it.
Among his siblings, Terence was the only one born out of wedlock to a different father.
I never knew my physical father, and I did not have a very comfortable relationship with the fine gentleman who portrayed the role of my stepfather, Reverend Darby. The roots of my desire for mass affection really began when a stepfather kind of comes in and basically demands his place at the tit. And if there's not this level of compatibility between you and him that you might have hoped for, it can kind of be It causes a separation anxiety and a separation trauma that basically you go to great lengths later to make up for.
Question I wanna know. Are you happy? Or are you afraid?
What I did feel was a sense of alienation that I don't think had anything to do with what was being offered to me by my other brothers and sisters. It was just something else that even from an early age I kind of felt alternatively connected to and missing. Church life is such a prescribed life that from a very early age you begin to avoid life, to not deal with life. You were pretty much encouraged to have a predigested identity and idea, and to veer from that was to risk private as well as, you know, public condemnation and reproach. It also encouraged an incredible amount of reflection, because when you are basically discouraged from action, the flip side is that you're able to spend more time in reflection. My mother's influence was certainly the most stable influence that I could have known at that particular time. But her influence was also very strong musically, because she was a musician as well as a great singer. She's a great musician as well. So her influence was very much encouraging me towards further developing the same inclination that I found within myself.
Sananda had never really been comfortable as Terence Trent D'Arby. He felt he'd reached a point where he couldn't go any further and literally had to become someone else.
You just draw from all that life has poured into you. I mean, everything that has happened to you up to that point, and to transform it into healing, to transform it into something good, something positive, to take the darkness and turn it back into, and transform it back into light.
Sing like a bandit, stealing time underneath the sycamore tree.
In the end, fame couldn't save Terence from his inner turmoil, but it seemed the visions which presented themselves in his dreams could.
I remember having a series of dreams where I was walking with a group of entities that I intuitively felt were angelic beings, but it wasn't like bunches of wings and nothing like that. It was just, in that dimension, they were felt very clearly as what they were. There was never really much said. We would just walk together, usually down like a kind of country road or a kind of nature path, something comfortable, peaceful. And it was at some point we would get to maybe a clearing in the field or something where I would then hear one of them call out the name Sananda. It would always like echo across the fields and stuff, like something Cecil B. DeMille. What I noticed was immediately when I heard that name, it was like a dog's ears perk up. And I kept looking for it. It was like not having heard that name in the context of the dream. I'm hearing it, and it sounded so familiar. It sounded frustratingly familiar. I became lucid in the middle of the dream and realized that if no one else is answering, then you're Sananda. And I realized that it was just a matter of using that experience to layer back in a vibration which had such a profound effect upon me.
Wish me love, wishing well, the kiss and tell. Oh,
everything positive that I've ever had happened to me in life has been a result of a dream. And I was never too enamored of the name Terence anyway. It has always had connotations that weighed more towards the negative in my experience than the positive. So it wasn't like I needed a great deal of encouragement anyway. But it was at a point in my life where the only way to survive it was to just completely let go.
In his mind, he rejected the person represented by Terence and became Sananda.
I was very awakened by it. The thing about awakening processes, however, is they don't necessarily stop where you think they're supposed to stop. They tend to unravel until they get to the full point, which is to deliver you back to the truth of who you really are.
But quickly, the blood rains.
Fassananda's experience was very painful. But now, looking back, he believes it's something he had to live through.
Sometimes we seem to, you know, come apart at the seams and go into some schizophrenic spin. But even that's cathartic. I think that our negative expression also has some creative and healing value. There are many people who make seemingly a negative music, but it's basically to help other people in that negative space connect with something so that they understand that they too are not alone. Wish me love, a wishing well, a kiss and tell, a wishing well, a butterfly tears, come on. The overwhelming impression I had of my experience was that by the time I was able to kind of finally maybe get comfortable in a chair, it had been pulled out from under me. So, okay, here we go again. Back down the rabbit hole. Now, having said all that, it was my karma, and it was what awakened me. It was designed to awaken me.
Sananda believes his dreams ultimately saved his life. He feels he emerged from them with a new identity and finally found himself.
There was even a point when I could have come back to it because something had been let go of. But at the same time, it didn't honor the part of me that didn't want to, that just was not that fond of it anyway. And was grateful that a layer had been taken away that seemed to be more suffocating than satisfying.
Sananda Maitreya is a successful singer-songwriter and has a loyal fan base in Europe. Once Sananda had found his inner peace, the rest fell into place. He now lives in Italy and has found long-term happiness with his wife, Francesca.
Until I got married, love for me was primarily a very romantic yet wistful experience. It had whetted my appetite very, very much, but never really fulfilled me. What was most positive about the experience of loneliness that I experienced before was that I was really able to see that there are so many things that we can fixate on as men that are important in relationships that just fade away after a while. And you're just basically looking for permission to be you, just to be in the presence of someone who loves so completely and without judgment and without condition, has truly given me a working day-to-day emotional understanding, not just a spiritual or intellectual understanding of kind of the concept of love. I understand it in a way now that I could not possibly have before, because I really needed it. That was the piece that was missing in my quest, was the acknowledgement that your anger at being abandoned before you were ready aside, you still at some point, the only thing that's going to heal that is turning back around and facing it and letting someone love you. That's been a tremendous thing to have experienced, because I can look at a lot of things that have happened to me and say, you know what, I deserve that. I worked my butt off, I put myself in a position, I made sacrifices, I deserve that. But my wife's love is something that I can't say I have done anything to deserve. You have to follow those under the laws of grace, because I don't really believe that a person can do such a thing as to deserve the manifestation of an angel that just supports the truth of who you are. It's really humbling, because I've just not done anything. No matter how many people's lives I've touched or encouraged, it still does not add up to feeling that I have the right to deserve such a love, such a wife.
Sananda has undertaken an extraordinary spiritual journey. He likens it to the process of a caterpillar changing into a butterfly, a transition he feels saved him from himself.
I can honestly say that there have been many times when it has literally saved my life. I found no therapy, at least more suited to whatever psychosis that has been my karma to bear. I can honestly say that it has been the medium I found most powerful in transporting me to states of ecstasy or catharsis that have just sustained my belief in what is good within us and what is good around us. It not only saved my life, it gave something back that I didn't even have before. So it's been one hell of a ride, Horatio, but it's been the ride I've needed to just bring me back to my real senses.